One. Welcome to Zion this morning as we worship these continued Sundays of Pentecost. We're reminded of God's presence to be with us through the Holy Spirit, especially in some challenging times. And so we're thankful you're here to worship with us. Of course, we know some of you might be worshiping with us later on as we're going to try and record it this morning to continue to connect all of us with the good news and the grace of Jesus. And so a couple of announcements, ways we can stay connected, ways we can serve in response to worship today. First, I want to let you know on your calendar, please mark next Sunday, just as we've adjusted to this two-service schedule. Next Sunday will be one service at 10 a.m. It will be a blended service again because it will mark a very significant day in the life of this congregation, as it will be my official installation, but it will also be a time where we gather together as community to commit to ourselves collectively to be a part of this next chapter together. You know, a new pastor isn't going to solve all your issues or concerns or problems. It's something we collectively will commit to next Sunday. So it will be a blended service. It will be one service at 10 o'clock with light refreshments afterwards. But certainly we appreciate your presence. And we'll have Pastor Bob Abrams, the assistant to the bishop, being our guest preacher next Sunday at 10 o'clock. Next month, as you're doing some fall cleaning, just keep track of all your clothes. If you're wanting to donate some of your gently used clothing, we will be beginning a clothing drive next month. And then also, if you have any paper or plastic bags that you're wanting, just kind of keeping track of, not sure what to do, they can go to the great ministry of the bake and book sale. So contact Pete, and we'll let you know where you can bring those in. Also, I know Tom has an announcement for us this morning, wherever he went.
The Zion retirees are going to have a program next month, but it's on the third Wednesday, the 20th of October. 12 o'clock for a brown bag lunch, and 12:30 we're having Dante Jones, the weatherman from Channel 7, come in and give a discussion. So it's not just for retirees. Anybody that wants to hear Dante talk, you're more than welcome to come.
Thanks, Tom. And finally, just some words on the differences this morning. We're actually going to spend some time in our sermon today, but want to thank you all for your intentionality in being thoughtful in how we can care for one another as a community. As we know, COVID-19 is still having an impact. It's not as though you get a new pastor and then all the worries of the world in the past year and a half have gone away, unfortunately. And so certainly I think we can all agree that some of this distancing and things like that, the visual reminders that the world isn't what we want it to be, is a little discouraging, I think, for all of us. But I am thankful on behalf of Church Council in your participation to being a part of the community that I believe in faith we'll get through this as we continue to care for one another. So what that means for worship this morning, certainly if you're wearing a mask, we support you in doing that. We have some distancing so that everyone feels comfortable and safe in this space as they worship. So we'll be singing as we have been. When it comes to time of Holy Communion, we'll come forward, just give each other a little bit more space. You'll come forward, you'll still receive the bread from me, the wine or the juice. The assisting minister and myself will be masked for everyone as you come forward. We'll still be singing. And then at the end of the service, when you go to Holy Grounds, if you want your cup of coffee, we're still doing that. We're basically asking that you just be thoughtful of those around you, whether they're wearing a mask or not, just kind of giving each other some space. And so we hope that this little bit of an inconvenience or a little bit of a challenge for all of us in terms of how we want to be community and connected and close is short-term, but it's something we do in sharing the love of Christ with a neighbor among us. Certainly in faith, we'll get through this. We're going to hear more about that in our sermon today. But as God's people, a challenging time, but we are all gathered together in Jesus' name. Let's begin our hearts for worship in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. So blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose teaching is life, whose presence is sure, and whose love is endless. Amen. Now let's confess our sins to the one who welcomes us with an open heart. God, our comforter, like lost sheep, we've gone astray. We gaze upon abundance and seek scarcely. We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression. We exploit the earth for our apathy and greed. Free us from our sin, gracious God. Listen when we call out to you for help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbor as ourselves. Friends, hear this good news, that all of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, but by the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes us righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. As you're able, invite to stand as we sing our gathering hymn. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and unity of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Lord be with you.
And also
let us pray together the prayer of the day. Generous God, your Son gave his life that we might come to peace with you. Give us a share of your Spirit in all we do, and empower us to bear the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated as we hear our scriptures for the day.
Our first reading this morning comes from the 11th chapter of Numbers. The rabble among them had a strong craving, and the Israelites also wept again and said, "If only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we used to eat in Egypt for nothing. The cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up, and there is nothing at all but this manna to look at." Moses heard the people weeping throughout their families and at all the entrances to their tents. Then the Lord became very angry, and Moses was displeased. So Moses said to the Lord, "Why have you treated your servant so badly? Why have I not found favor in your sight that you lay the burden of all these people upon me? Did I conceive all these people? Did I give birth to them that you should say to me, 'Carry in your bosom, as a nurse carries a sucking child, to the land that you promised on oath to their ancestors'? Where am I to get meat to give all these people? For they come weeping to me and say, 'Give us meat to eat.' I am not able to carry all these people alone, for they are too heavy for me. If this is the way you're going to treat me, put me to death at once. If I have found favor in your sight, do not let me see my misery." So the Lord said to Moses, "Gather for me 70 of the elders of Israel, whom you know to be the elders of the people and officers over them. Bring them to the tent of the meeting and have them take their place there with you." So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord, and he gathered 70 elders of the people and placed them all around the tent. Then the Lord came down in a cloud and spoke to him, took some of the spirit that was on him and put it on the 70 elders. And when the spirit rested upon them, they prophesied, but they did not do so again. Two men remained in the camp, one named Eldad and the other named Medad. And the spirit rested on them, and they were among those registered, but they had not gone out to the tent. So they prophesied in the camp. And a young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." And Joshua, son of Nun, the assistant of Moses, one of his chosen men, said, "My Lord Moses, stop them." But Moses said to him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, and the Lord would put his spirit on them." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We shall read responsively Psalm number 19. "The teaching of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the simple. The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are than gold, more than much fine gold, sweeter far than honey in the comb. By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward. Who can detect one's own offenses? Cleanse me from my secret faults. Above all, keep your servant from the presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound and innocent of a great offense. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. The second reading comes from the 5th chapter of James. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up, and anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel this morning is in the 9th chapter of Mark. Beginning in verse 38, we hear, John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him. For no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose their reward. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and to go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and to be thrown into hell, where the worm never dies, and a fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. This is the gospel, the good news of our Lord. After all the rehabilitation I did with, being blind in my ride, I was able to drive, but had had all my driving classes in Columbus, Ohio. City streets, smooth, wide, paved lines. Winter time of year, which is when this story I'm going to tell you about happened. There wasn't much snow in Columbus yet, and so then when I went to visit my family in Northeast Ohio, they're north, but where they still get what's called lake effect snow. So it's all that extra oomph that the snowstorms get off of Lake Erie. So they still get some of that extra snow. So coming from Columbus, where there have been paved, clean streets, go up to visit my family out in the country with country roads that aren't quite 2 cars wide. And this particular weekend on Graffis Road, which is the main road that led to my parents' farm, total snow. And not just snow, but the way the road went, it would receive the wind either from the east or the west, so it was often the quickest road in town to get totally snowed shut. The drifts would start to grow. And this is what had happened this particular weekend. And my dad said, well, we have this car, you know, your mom has this SUV, why don't you practice driving so get used to driving in the snow? And so I said, well, are you sure about this? And he said, sure, and I white-knuckled the steering wheel and kind of took a little deep breath. As we had driven in Ashland, the roads were clear, but I knew to get home, we were going to have to go down Graffis Road, and I already knew what it looked like. So as I turn onto Graffis Road, and you see about a half mile straight away, it was really hard to see where the ditch started and where the road began. And you'd always look ahead and find out if there was a car coming, because if there was, you kind of had to decide who would go first and who would wait, because both cars were not going to fit under nice circumstances, let alone snow. Luckily, no car was coming, and so I thought, okay, let's just go straight. And you could just see a little bit of a dimple in the snow where I could tell where the ditch was, and I wanted to stay away from that. But it was kind of a little bit of glare out, and so we're staying straight, and my mom was less calm in the back seat. My dad was, hey, you might want to go to the left a little bit because the snow started to pull us closer to the right, where the ditch was. And he kept calmly saying, you know, go left, oh, and then suddenly it was too late. The snow in the ditch had just pulled us in to the ditch. So much so, in the angle of the ditch in the snow, that we all had to climb out the driver's side of the car. I thought, surely. It's a fairly new car to my parents. You know, my dad had told me several times, to the left, to the left, to the left. I was already, you know, embarrassed that was worried that I had messed up my parents' car. Thankfully, I didn't. But at the time, I was expecting the justified, tough words of, you know, why weren't you listening? I kept saying to the left, something like that, and that never came. Thankfully, in that moment, my dad appreciated that I probably didn't need, just the concern for that I wrecked the car with my parents inside in their car was maybe consequence enough. And we went up to the house, got the tractor, pulled out the car, and had a cup of coffee and hot coffee, and he just talked about, you know, kind of some learning points. Wasn't upset, but I wasn't receiving that condemnation that I had justly deserved for ditching my parents' car. So as a preacher, and you all know, we have what is called the Revised Common Lectionary. It is what assigns our scripture readings for any given Sunday. The opportunity in that is that if you are here every single Sunday over, I think, about 3 years, you will have heard something of about 80% of the many parts of scripture. Also, it is pretty cool when you think of unity, when it's not just Lutherans, it could be Presbyterians, it could be Methodists, or whoever uses what we call the lectionary, as knowing we're all kind of reading the same pieces of God's word on a Sunday throughout the country, throughout the world. The challenge as a preacher, though, is that sometimes the lectionary then will challenge us to address issues that otherwise we would not choose to address on our own, kind of like our gospel or all of our scriptures today. You know, you hear about the first reading of Moses is just complaining. Psalms can be helpful, but they're kind of a little hit and miss sometimes. And our second reading then is talking about being careful and preventing people from backsliding. Maybe you're thinking, am I one of them? And we thought, okay, that's fine. As a preacher, I thought, well, no good with numbers. The second reading, not so much. And then I thought, well, the gospel. Certainly the gospel, which means good news will give us some help today. And it's Jesus talking about, or the disciples complaining about someone who is casting out demons in Jesus' name, but they're unhappy about it. They're arguing like they do often because they're not doing it their way with them. And it could be an opportunity for us to reflect on how kind of some of these changes in worship this morning, how some changes in our lives are a way that we can give a cup of cool water to someone amongst us. We can talk about ways that sometimes we aren't willing to give that cup of cool water. We can talk about how people have faith, especially in our country, that we're so divided. What does it mean when Jesus says, if they're not against us, they are for us? Maybe we could reflect on the times. And like the disciples, we get upset because, man, that big church is really doing great work, but they're not doing it like us, and so we become upset. Or maybe we dismiss really tiny churches. Or we talk about they and them, and maybe they're doing good work, and maybe they're even doing God's work in Jesus' name, but we're upset because they're not doing it with us. But as a preacher, it's helpful, and you've all trusted me to know, when are times that we need to hear what is called the law? In our Lutheran tradition, we have ways of talking about law and gospel. Law is not only like speed limits and do not kill, but law is about those aspects of our faith when that law is something that reminds us that life isn't quite as we'd like it to be. Maybe it's about reminding, hey, sometimes we fall short. What can we do better next time? The law, as I've taught in seminary, is kind of like the diagnosis. It reminds us that things aren't as we'd like them to be. And so as your preacher, teacher this morning, I kind of did what you'd say is read the room, know your audience. And, you know, we're all starting to get to know each other. We're about 2 months right now. But my assumption would be that you all don't need reminded that life isn't as we would like it to be today. I mean, these ribbon reminders are that visual reminder that life is not quite as we'd like it to be. So instead of spending the rest of our time with law and reminding of the imperfections and challenges of life that we all are experiencing today, I'd like to share with you some gospel. Not just from the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but as gospel is what we call the good news. I'd like to share with you the very first story of good news, which has always been the heart of why the church exists, and it's been the source of church's hope. So from the Gospel of Luke, the 24th chapter, is the telling of Jesus' resurrection. So, but on the first day of the week at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking their barrel of spices they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling white clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not dead, but he is risen. Remember how he told you, while he was still in Galilee, the Son of Man must be handed over by sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered Jesus' words. Returning from the tomb, they told all of this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the disciples. If I'm really honest with you, a moment of vulnerability this morning is this past Friday when I brought in the spool of ribbon, a little special tape to protect the pews, and the scissors, they felt especially heavy. Kind of imagine that those burial spices that the women brought to the tomb felt especially heavy. Heavy from their grief, their worry, their sadness, of their hopes dashed, their expectations defeated, as they carried those burial spices to the tomb. Kind of how I felt on Friday, because I'll admit to you, it felt a little eerie to be putting ribbon and sectioning off pews and seats. Kind of gave me a flashback to what I did in the previous congregation a year and a half before. We remember that time when we all had questions on what will this be like? Will we get through this? What implications will this have in my faith? And then what implications will this have in the life of the congregation? A lot of uncertainty, a lot of questions. And then we rise today. We show up in this place, and maybe on your way here this morning, the mask that you thought you were done wearing felt a little extra heavy this morning. Or maybe your heart felt a little extra heavy this morning when you walked in here and you just felt that, separating? We're supposed to be community, we're supposed to be together, and here we are back here again. My guess is that we don't need to hear the law, the reminders of the difficulties of life, because we're all experiencing that heaviness this morning. Much like those women, the first Easter preachers experienced that heaviness of those burial spices they carried to the tomb that first Easter morning. And so whatever heaviness, whatever source you're carrying this morning, I want to share with you that good news that the women need to be reminded of Jesus' promise with them. Yes, he'd go through difficult things, but they would not have the end, that he would bring about resurrection and new life. Then they remember. Then they went and told the disciples the good news. And so in all the heaviness that is this morning, I have hope. I hope that you can have hope so that we all have hope. You know, because honestly, I thought, you know, these first like 6 weeks, it's this new excitement, this great call, and I'm still excited to be your pastor, but even more so today, I have hope. Even when sections are ribboned off, even when life is going to feel a little awkward as we give each other more space, maybe we're caring more about the heaviness of life and thinking more about what we carry around. I am even more hopeful as we are reminded of Jesus' promise with the first witnesses of the resurrection, as Jesus' promise to us today. Jesus has never promised that as a follower of Jesus, life will be easy. In fact, Jesus says the opposite, that sometimes life will be difficult. Sometimes in this world, he says in the Gospel of Mark, you'll have troubles, but I have overcome the world. So this morning, with all the heaviness that is life, may be reminded of Jesus' promise that none of these things will be the end of us. None of these things will define us, because the church has always been defined by new life in Jesus. by the power and the hope, the promise of the resurrection. May we be reminded of that. May we remind one another of that hope. May that be the hope that inspires us to share that and to care for others. Maybe that might just empower us to give a cold cup of water, of refreshment to those around us. For God, who continues to refresh our souls like a cold cup of water, we can give thanks today and always, because Christ is still risen, giving us new life today. Amen. Using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. I invite you to remain seated or to kneel as we pray for the church, the world, those close to us, and those we have yet to meet. Trusting God's abundant mercy and presence promised to be with us, let us pray for the church, the world, and one another. Gracious God, we thank you for hearing us, being with us, and gathering us today as we lift up these prayers to you. This morning we pray for the church and its ministry, Bless the newly baptized and encourage them in their journey of faith. Sustain all members of the body of Christ in lives of prayer, service, and worship. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for natural wonders of your creation, local waterways, forests, other natural areas which give us rest and peace. Restore damaged forests, waterways, and natural habitats, and lead us to be good stewards, to care what you have provided for us. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those in authority. Give them wise minds and compassionate hearts. Strengthen in them a desire to protect the vulnerable, to care for those undeserved, underserved. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those serving in healthcare. Strengthen hospital staff, from boards and executives to cleaning and hospital staff. Pray for the doctors, nurses, techs, and aides who continue to sacrifice time from their families and risk their own safety, sometimes with limited resources or full units, to continue to serve and care for those in need. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who are struggling with physical, mental, or emotional illnesses, for those enduring cancer, dementia, or other diseases. Provide them with peace and resilience for the days ahead. Sustain caregivers with energy and patience. Lord, in your mercy. This morning we pray for those who grieve. For those, we ask that you comfort those who have lost loved ones. Be the families and communities affected by COVID-19. Embrace the students, staff, and families in Miamisburg as they grieve the loss of a teacher and staff. Wipe their tears and give them your peace. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the worship leaders of this congregation. We thank you for the work of musicians, readers, ushers, and greeters. Bless us through their ministry and grant them the passion to continue in their service. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, we also lift up to you prayers of our hearts as we pray today for Marilyn Mitchell. May you continue to give her peace and recovery. Also pray that you be with Fred this week, preparing for his surgery. May you give him strength and recovery in time. We also thank you for the gift of life and celebration. So we thank you for those in our midst in birthdays this week, for Finn, for Judy, and Cheryl. Lord, in your mercy. Now we lift up to you, O God, prayers of our hearts, silently or spoken. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, we give you thanks for all those who have impacted our faith who have gone on before us, and all the saints, those who you have loved, who continue to love, and they have loved us. We thank you for how they've helped us to know and experience your love when they've known us in every time since. Continue to guide us by their example and reassure us of your forever permanent salvation. Gracious God, we lift up to you all these prayers, trusting in your endless grace, your promise of new life for us. Pray all these prayers in Jesus' name, the resurrected one who is our hope. Amen. And seated, and now we respond to God's grace and generosity by gathering our offerings and tithes. let's give thanks for all God has given us. Let us pray together. God of abundance, you cause streams to break forth in the desert, and manna to rain from the heavens. Accept the gifts you have first given us. Unite them with the offering of our lives to nourish the world we love so dearly. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praises.
It is indeed right, our calling and our joy, that we should at all times and all places give thanks and praise to Almighty God, with your very word that brought life out of a formless void, with that same word that brought life and sustenance to the people in their wilderness journey, is that same word that became life through Jesus, that same word in Jesus that brought about new life and resurrection to those first Easter witnesses and even to us today. And so for that same promise of new life and resurrection, we join all those gathered in worship today in praising your name and singing their hymn without end. Whenever we gather as God's people, as often as we can, we gather around God's table, reminder of the night in which he's betrayed, in which his love was poured out for all. But it's not only a night of sadness, but through the power of the resurrection has also become a meal of hope for us. But today we remember that night in which he was betrayed. Our Lord Jesus took bread. After giving thanks, he broke it, gave it to them and said, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way, after the meal when Jesus had given thanks, he took the cup, gave it to them, and said, "Take and drink, all of you. This cup is the new promise in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sins, as often as you drink from it to do, for the remembrance of me." Trusting in the holy mystery and gift that Jesus is present in, with, and through this meal, let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So, of course, if you are a guest with us this morning, we are thankful for your presence. We invite all to come to God's table, as through baptism, God embraces us into community. It is at this table that God strengthens community. And so all are invited to this table to be fed. God sends no one away hungry. The way we'll do that this morning here at Zion is you'll come up the center aisle at the instruction of the usher, come forward and receive a piece of bread from me, and then from the tray, either red wine or juice in the center of the tray, and then you can discard of your empty cups as you go back down the side aisle. Of course, this morning, I invite you to be thoughtful and just a distance between one another. And instead of singing while we're receiving communion, we're inviting you to a time of reflection. However, we will have special music. We continue in these times with hope and faith, knowing that as we come to God's table, there's more than enough for all. Amen. May you see you. Be reminded that the body, blood, and blessing of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ are God's gifts to strengthen and keep you now and forever. Amen.
Life, in the gift of your body and blood, you turn the crumbs of our faith into a feast of salvation. Send us forth into the world with shouts of joy, bearing witness to the abundance of your love in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
From this time of worship and service, to continue lives of service and worship, to both carrying around those heavy things in our life and yet to be reminded and to do the reminding that Christ is risen, that there is promise of new life for all. So as you go to do that work, people of God, know you are Christ's body in the world, bringing new life to a suffering world. May the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever, be with you always. Amen. As you're able, we sing our ascending hymn.
Grow in faith. Serve with love. Thanks be to God.